name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. You sit, please. Before I get to my sermon proper, let me tell you a joke. It's in a context. The Sunday Times reports today that John Sentamu, the former Archbishop of York, has been turned down for a peerage, the first time an archbishop has ever been denied this. And the reason given in the Sunday Times is that he tells jokes. So let me tell you one of his jokes. It's not very mischievous or anything. A plane is flying over the Atlantic. It starts losing height, and the captain realizes the only way to save the plane is to throw some of the passengers overboard. And he announces this on the tannoy and says, since this is an equal opportunities airline, we'll go through in alphabetical order as to who's to be chucked out. And so he says, are there any Africans here? Absolute silence. Are there any black people here? Silence. Are there any people from the Caribbean? Silence. And the little boy tugs on his father's sleeve and says, what are we? And the father says, we're Zulus. I think that's quite nice. And telling a joke like that debars you from any preferment in the Church of England. Anyway, on to my sermon proper. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, I've said that, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. When I was in a pop group back in the 1960s, what would now be called a band, one of my favorite songs to sing was called Amamam, Amamam. And it was about a man who was unlucky in love, so unlucky that he was reduced to spending his time on the park bench just mumbling, Amamam, Amamam. Now, the man who sang that song, called Glyn Ellis, also was unlucky in love, unlucky in lots of other things as well, and became bankrupt eventually. And he died about 2 or 3 months ago. His name, as I say, is Glyn Ellis. Now, I doubt if any of you have heard of Glyn Ellis. You may conceivably have heard of his stage name, Wayne Fontana. Any takers for that? Oh, yes, one or two takers. And Wayne was after John Wayne, whose career had been revived recently by the Alamo. He was David Crockett in that. And Fontana, most obscurely, was after Elvis Presley's session drummer. So he became Wayne Fontana. Now, thinking of more obscure pop musicians, have you heard of Ricky Valance, anybody? Any takers of Ricky Valance? Not really. Sounds cool and trendy, Ricky Valance. Sounds American, and in those days, America was cool. I think it still is. And so he adopted the name Ricky Valance. In fact, he was Dave, Dave Spencer from the Welsh Valleys. Just to mention the song, just to remind you, some of you may remember this, there were lots of songs in those days, this is the early 1960s, about people who died for love. And in this case, this chap had gone to a stock car race to have some winnings that he could then buy a wedding ring for his girlfriend. But sadly, he died in a stock car accident. And his last words were, tell Laura I love her. We remember it, don't we? 1960, that was. It dates us. Let me mention one or two obscure pop singers. One or two more. Shane Fenton and the Fentones had a couple of hits in the 1960s, then reincarnated themselves in the glam rock days of the 70s. He was Alvin Stardust and had two more hits. Well, his real name was Jeff. Jeff from Muswell Hill. And wasn't Shane Fenton or Alvin Stardust at all. Just another one, a couple of ones. There was a fashion in those days for vaguely dangerous names. So there was Billy Fury and Marty Wilde. And Marty Wilde was actually Reg Smith. And Billy Fury was Ron Witcherly. So Reg and Ron. So we've now got Dave and Reg and Ron and Jeff. Mention one more. My favorite dangerous name was Rory Storm and the Hurricanes, a Liverpool band. At one stage, they were more popular than the Beatles at the Cavern Club. But Rory Storm, despite his brave-sounding name, was actually very shy and wouldn't go up to London to record his songs. So he never had any hit records, and obviously the Beatles far surpassed him and had dozens of hit records. So that's a slightly sad story. Now, I hope it doesn't seem blasphemous if I relate these rather stupid pop star names to the names that God gives to himself in the Bible. pop stars chose those names to communicate something of themselves, to say something about me. God chose the names of himself in the Bible to speak to us, to communicate to us about himself. And so let's think of the most precious name of all to us, the divine name, Jesus Christ. Now, at one level, that's very simple what that means. Christ is the anointed one, the Messiah, so he's the anointed one, the Messiah that had been expected. And Jesus is, via Latin and Greek and so on, Joshua. Joshua becomes Jesus. So, Joshua the Christ. Now, that name Joshua, means rescuer. So here we have Joshua, the rescuer, the savior of the world, the anointed one. That's simply what the name means. But there's another facet of the name Joshua that intrigues me. It had this view I'm about to express has absolutely no scholarly backing whatever, but it's in my mind. You may remember about 25 or 30 years ago, there was a huge fashion for the name Joshua. Suddenly it became very fashionable for little boys to be called that. Every third christening I did in those days, I seemed to be christening yet another Joshua. And our very own Joshua is a product of that period when it was tremendously popular. It still is quite popular. If you look up the stats, as it were, it's number 18th in the hit parade of popular boys' names. So it still is there, but not quite at the top as it once was when our Joshua was born. So it's a common or garden name. It's an anti-glamorous name. Rather than being Wayne or Ricky or those glamorous names, it's a Ron and Reg sort of name, a Dave and Jeff sort of name. That's what Joshua is. And I hope I'm not insulting our dear Joshua here, but it's a Ron and Reg sort of name. And that surely is the point that the name is getting across to us, that actually Jesus as a man was Ron or Reg, the sort of person we might meet any time. He led a normal life. He ate normal food. He lived in a normal house. And his mum cooked normal meals, I'm quite sure. He learnt a normal trade, carpentry. And it's quite possible that they had a little allotment, as Sarah and I do, out of town somewhat. And he grew vegetables and fruit in the normal kind of a way. He was a normal bloke. He was a Ron and a Reg or a Jeff or a Dave. And I like to think that, like most young boys in teenage years, he liked a bit of rough and tumble. So maybe he joined the Nazareth Rugby Club. It's all quite possible. He was an ordinary person. He was a Ron or a Reg. And that seems to me, that double meaning, is what it's all about. The double meaning of Joshua, on the one hand, the savior of the world, that's what the name literally means, the rescuer. On the other hand, a normal bloke. And the great glory and mystery of the incarnation is that an ordinary bloke becomes God, and God becomes an ordinary bloke. That seems to me a most inspiring and wonderful thought contained in the double meaning of the name Joshua. Now, all of us have, I'm sure, been rather fed up with our names at one stage or another in our lives. When I was young, I thought how much better it would be to be Cliff or Elvis. Why did I have to be Robert? What a dreary name compared with those glamorous names. And then when I got a bit older and grew into late teenagehood and I became a very patriotic Englishman, I thought, why am I called Vanderwyer? I'm not foreign, I'm English. I was stuck with a foreign name. I dare say at times in your long lives you've had similar thoughts about your own name. The trouble is you can't really change it. I could legally change my name to something more glamorous, but I can't really. I am my name. You become your name. Your name becomes you. You can't escape from it. I expect Cliff Richard, who's been Cliff Richard for about 60 years, still thinks to himself, I'm actually boring old Harry Webb. We're stuck with our names. Now, we know that Jesus the Christ often found his mission as being the savior of the world extremely hard, hardly surprising. He had to retreat into the wilderness from time to time to recuperate. And at the climax of his mission as savior of the world, when he was about to be crucified, he said, take this cup away from me. He didn't want to go through with it. He didn't want to be his name. But he was his name. Ultimately, he knew he had no choice but to be Joshua, the ordinary bloke that's the savior of the world. And that brings us back to Rory Storm. Rory Storm and the Hurricanes, when they were on stage, they would, actually all the time, I think, they would wear pink jackets and pink suits and a pink necktie. That was their kind of trademark look. And in 1962, when they were at the height of their fame, they splashed out the huge sum of £800 to buy a Vauxhall Cresta car, which is a kind of vague sports car, and they painted it pink. So there we are. That was their height of glamour, to have pink car and pink suits. But then, in 1963, Rory's dad died. And Rory's mum suffered badly from asthma, lived in the back street of Liverpool, and couldn't really look after herself. So Rory gave up all the glamour of being a pop star and went back to the back streets of Liverpool and lived with mum and looked after her. And if you popped into the local Methodist church at any time, any Sunday around that time, there would be Rory Storm, whose real name was Alan Cardwell, singing his heart out with the Wesley hymns. Now that seems to me to tell us a little bit about what I'm saying about the Incarnation. There was an ordinary bloke, not Rory Storm, but Alan Cardwell, doing a wonderful thing, looking after his mother. He had the Joshua had of the ordinary bloke had a fragment of Joshua, the saviour of the world, and that's true for all of us.